Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Trusted Advisor, 20th Anniversary Edition, by David H. Maister, Charles H. Green, and Robert M. Galford. Narrated by B.J. Harrison. Publisher's Note: In this audio edition, you'll hear references to visual elements present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Foreword to the 20th Anniversary Edition. Way back in 1995, Rob and Charlie were called into Deloitte to work on a large executive education program. The night before the first session, the head of the program, John Barch, said he had a half hour open and asked the two if they could throw together some thoughts on the idea of a trusted advisor. They quickly agreed, did so, and it went well. The client asked if they could do it again for the next session, and see if you can make it an hour. Next time, it became 2 hours. One of the attendees suggested, "I think you may have a book here." Rob and Charlie realized he was right, and began to think about organizing their insights. Initially, publishers and agents weren't keen on the idea. The reigning paradigm business book of the time was Good to Great, which was loaded with data. This was more of a wisdom book. Then Rob met David. David had already published 9 books, 3 of which were on professional service topics, and said, "I'm working on basically the same idea. Let's join forces." David connected us with his publisher, Simon & Schuster, and we were in business. The book was thus less intentional than fortuitous. David had focused on professional services, and the advisory component of that business represented an opportunity for him to explore. For Charlie and Rob, coming out of 20 years of consulting and professional services experience, the opportunity to share learnings and to write a first book was enticing. Looking back, none of us would describe a 3-author approach to book writing as easy, but it did offer the benefits of more and richer examples, and of forcing us to vet ideas with each other. Still, if it hadn't been for John Barch, if it hadn't been for Rob and David bumping into each other, if it hadn't been for any number of events, this book would not have happened. Perhaps someone else would have written it. After all, the term trusted advisor was in common parlance, was already being used in ad copy, and was well beyond the point of being copyrightable. Nonetheless, we were confident that this was one of those intuitively attractive phrases that no one had bothered to take seriously enough to rigorously explore the whys and hows that made it so powerful. Fortuitous it may have been, but we did have some shared views of what we wanted the book to be. Above all, we wanted it to be rooted in common sense, more grounded in practice than in theory. Our heavy focus on lists, David's idea, turned out to be one of the more attractive components of the book, as many later told us. The most important part of the book turned out to be the trust equation, a format inspired by an earlier consulting firm, but which we populated with our richer content. The idea of describing a soft concept using the language of simple mathematics turned out to be quite appealing to our audience. To oversimplify, the most common reaction to the book was, "I kind of knew or believed much of this already, but I've never seen it put together so well. It all just makes sense. It made me wonder why I wasn't doing this all before, and gave me the roadmap to start doing it." But there was a range of reactions. One CEO told us, "You have transformed this organization." Many people have commented that the book helped them navigate personal relationships outside of business. Many more have found it useful to create alignment around customer-facing people, simply by creating a shared language and culture. Still more have stated variations on the theme of, "The book helped me shift the way I think about my client relationships and the way I interact with my clients." People highlight a greater willingness to listen, an understanding of the several ways in which they can increase their trustworthiness, changes in the way they approach business development, and developing a more patient, outside-looking-in perspective on what their clients are thinking. All of these are, of course, gratifying to us. Fast forward 20 years, and several hundred thousand copies later, we realized we had latched onto something truly special. We also realized that the world has changed considerably since we first put pen to paper. We were reminded of Jorge Luis Borges' famous short story that describes the efforts of a 20th century author to write the world's greatest book. Considering Cervantes' Don Quixote to be the world's greatest book, he sets out to rewrite Don Quixote, exactly, word for word. However, once having written it, some four centuries after the original, he realizes that historical context renders everything different to the modern reader. Hence, his Don Quixote was not the same as the original, and so he had failed to write the world's greatest book. At the risk of comparing ourselves with authorial nobility, neither is The Trusted Advisor the same book we wrote 20 years ago. The context has changed. In particular, digital has happened, with effects ranging from trivial to profound. By way of context, when The Trusted Advisor came out in 2000, Mark Zuckerberg had not yet entered college, where he would start Facebook in his Harvard dorm 4 years later. A small company named Google had been founded just 2 years before. The first iPhone lay 7 years in the future. To say that the digital revolution has fundamentally changed business would be the understatement of several decades. To list just a few examples, much more information is available and used in the course of business relationships. In particular, each party to any business interaction is significantly smarter at earlier stages of interaction because of the ubiquity of available information. This affects relationship development, decision-making processes, and the dynamics of influence. Communications have shifted radically from phones, voicemail, faxes, and paper to all manner of digital vehicles. Big data, search, AI, and cloud computing have transformed sales and marketing, advertising, and buying processes. Tech itself has burgeoned into a massive industry, creating new clients and new advisors. Social media have affected nearly every aspect of business, to say nothing of life itself. Every one of those examples has potential implications for the idea of a trusted advisor. We toyed with the idea of a separate chapter specifically to address things digital, but ended up embedding these issues throughout the original structure. That decision reflects our belief that while digital is pervasive, it does not fundamentally alter the basics and dynamics of personal trust. The challenge is not to adapt trust to digital, but to adapt digital to trust. But digital effects are not the only way in which the context has shifted. Our audience has also changed. We originally wrote specifically for consultants, lawyers, accountants, and other advisory professional services. Today, advisory roles in business are widespread outside the locus of traditional professional services. For example, what used to be called tech support has morphed into far larger, strategically relevant business units. Entirely new organizational units like customer success have become ubiquitous. Those who work in the field of team and managerial dynamics have discovered that trusted advisor relationships have a lot to say about mentors, coaches, people, and leadership development. Coaches and financial advisors have found the book and found it to be useful. We are gratified, of course, to have found new audiences, but it makes us wonder how many potential new readers have yet to discover the book. As a result, we've included examples from all of those fields, and, where useful, adapted the language to make it more obviously applicable to them. The nature of business relationships has also changed. 20 years ago, hierarchical models of organization and leadership still held sway, affecting the dynamics between parties. Today, horizontal business relationships are far more the rule, both within and across organizations. Leadership is less a matter of competence and charisma, and more a function of the ability to influence. And since the ability to influence is at the heart of the advisor part of trusted advisor, the shift from hierarchical to horizontal relationships makes the book even more relevant. The demographics of readers have also changed. A typical reader of the original book in 2000 might have been 35 years old, likely male, born in 1965. A typical reader in 2020 may be closer to 30 years old, born in 1990, with readership much more gender-balanced, the latter point reflecting gains made in the professional services industry itself. That's a 25-year gap, a generation, and a culturally significant one. Original readers knew John, Paul, George, and Ringo as part of their life. For readers today, the Beatles are literally historical figures. Given all those changes, we are gratified that the book has done as well as it has. Sales have remained remarkably constant over two decades, due in part, we suspect, to the broadening audience, and we believe it can do better as we more specifically address them. Also, the book is particularly relevant for the middle part of a professional's career, which suggests the relevant audience is constantly being refreshed. More than one reader told us that they came to the book through the recommendation of a parent who had encountered it at a similar point in their own career. As well, when we floated the idea of this new addition to readers, they told us clearly that if we were to update the book, it had to speak to a new generation in that generation's terms. We agreed. That meant from things like getting rid of an old chapter on Lieutenant Columbo, if you have to ask, and references to faxes, again, to revising pronouns, and many points in between, like taking care to explain some points differently, while adding more on some issues and less on others. It wasn't until we started the job that we recognized yet another change. This one, in the understanding of the very word trust itself. 20 years ago, trust, in the business context, generally referred to interpersonal trust, including the personal relationship between advisor and client. Interpersonal trust, however, is not the only kind of trust that exists. In particular, there is institutional trust, the kind of trust referred to when we say things like, "I trust Apple more than Facebook," or "Trust in the criminal justice system has declined." In the current business and general environment, institutional trust is more frequently discussed than it was 20 years ago. More of our clients are now asking, "How can our company become more trusted?" In using trust this way, the word begins to overlap with terms like branding or reputation. We also increasingly find the word trust used with issues of data privacy and security. The ultimate example might be Forrester Research's zero trust model for network security. To oversimplify, it suggests that the most trustworthy digital network is one that has zero reliance on personal trust, because personal trust implies risk, and the intent is to eliminate risk. Since trust, by all definitions, implies risk-taking, this apparent contradiction just highlights the multi-layered meanings of the word in common usage today. All this linguistic variation suggests the need for us to be more precise about what we mean by the word trust. To be clear, this book is primarily about interpersonal trust, not institutional trust. The fact that interpersonal trust, nowadays, occupies proportionately less space in public or business dialogue does not mean its importance has diminished. If anything, we argue, the opposite is true. It is tempting to think that the need for interpersonal trust is diminished by the reduction in the time we spend in face-to-face communications, by automated processes, or by putting information on websites as opposed to communicating it personally. But the human need to deal with a human counterpart at some point in a business relationship is undiminished. If we are seeking advice, if we are going to make a significant commitment to another entity, we want a counterparty that on some level we know in order to have trust. We want accountability. We want to know who is behind the relationship. We want names. We want to put faces, depth, and values to those names. If there are fewer personal interactions, then the weight we place on the remaining interactions becomes even greater. In this way, the importance of interpersonal trust is actually heightened. Another definitional point is useful. Since 2000, there has been an explosion of research and business literature on trust. Much of it treats trust as a thing in itself, without revealing much about how trust is created. This results in a very practical form of confusion. Here is the problem. If trust is down, whether for a personal or institutional relationship, then does the problem lie in reduced trustworthiness of one party, or does it lie in reduced willingness to trust by the other party? Simply observing the end result, lower trust, obscures the root of the problem, and therefore the practical solutions to that problem. For example, if we see a statement like, "Trust in banking is down," no matter how rigorous the statistical study may be, it begs a fundamental question. Is trust in banking down because A, banks have become less trustworthy, or B, because people have come to trust banks less? If you see a particular bank, mortgage lender, or financial firm frequently in the news over a matter of years for bad sales practices, odds are good you're seeing evidence of a failure of trustworthiness. But consider another case. In the United States, the incidence of violent crime has been measurably down over the last two decades. At the same time, fear of violent crime has just as measurably increased. That is a problem of perception, an unwillingness to trust. If all we measure is trust, then we have no practical way of addressing the problem. Is it the propensity to trust on the part of the truster, or is it the trustworthiness of the trustee? Since our aim was to write a book that is above all practical, this is an important point. So here are our definitions, distinguishing trust, trustworthiness, and trusting. Trust is one kind of relationship between two persons. Trust increases when one partner, the truster, takes a risk by trusting the other, and the other party, the trustee, proves themselves to be trustworthy. aspiring trusted advisors are often tempted to focus solely on being trustworthy and not on trusting. This is a mistake. Just as in the sales world, aggressively waiting for the phone to ring is no strategy, so it is with trust. If you want to build trust, you must learn to play the proactive, risk-taking role of truster, as well as that of trustee. As we look back on the first 20 years of this book's life, and dare to think about the next 20, one thing above all seems clear to us. As the song says, the fundamental things apply as time goes by. Technology changes. Markets and organizations change. Demographics, business roles, and communications media change. What stays constant are human dynamics, including the dynamics of trust. We have tried to separate the signal from the noise, confident that the signal remains strong. We are grateful to previous readers and hope you may enjoy a look anew, along with people who are reading this book for the first time. David H. Maister, Boston, Massachusetts. Charles H. Green, Boca Raton, Florida. Robert M. Galford, Concord, Massachusetts. Introduction. We wrote this book because, in the course of our careers as consultants and as advisors to other professionals, we have made every mistake we describe in the book and broken every piece of advice it contains. Whatever wisdom this book contains has been learned the hard way. Our formal education served us well, but nothing in it prepared us for the real world of trying to serve clients effectively. Along the way, we learned that becoming a good advisor takes more than having good advice to offer. There are additional skills involved, one that no one ever teaches you, that are critical to your success. Most important, we learned that you don't get the chance to employ advisory skills until you can get someone to trust you enough to share their problems with you. No one ever taught us how to do that either, yet we had to learn it somehow. For several years, Rob Galford and Charlie Green had been conducting workshops, seminars, and training programs for some of the world's most prominent professional firms under the title of Being a Trusted Advisor. Meanwhile, David Maister was consulting and writing about professionalism, advice giving, client relationships, and other related topics. We met when we found ourselves presenting at the same conference and realized that, separately, we each had a piece of the puzzle. Together, we think we have a total picture to present. The theme of this book is that the key to professional success is not just technical mastery of one's discipline, which is, of course, essential, but also the ability to work with clients in such a way as to earn their trust and gain their confidence. We therefore address this book to both would-be advisors and to existing advisors who seek to create trust in their business relationships. We have written it mostly for individuals working in the advisory professions: consulting, accounting, law, engineering, public relations, talent, insurance brokerage, investment banking, architecture, and similar activities. We have written it that way because that is the world we know. However, we hope that professionals working inside corporations and other organizations who also have clients and projects will find this book relevant to their work. Trust takes place between two individuals. It can, of course, take place inside organizations, within teams, and in other group settings. But we have chosen in this book to focus on the primary aspect of trust, that which occurs between two individuals, an advisor serving a client. Ambitious professionals invest tremendous energy in improving business skills, including sharpening their specific expertise, gaining experience, broadening their knowledge, and networking, all requiring hard work. However, seldom do they give enough thought to creating trust relationships with clients, and little guidance is provided by their firms on how to accomplish this. Many professionals do not know how to think about or examine trust relationships. Unfortunately, there are many signs that trust is scarce. With ever-increasing frequency, clients conduct a microscopic examination of their professional provider's bills, challenging expenses, questioning how projects were staffed, and how much time various tasks required. Clients often exclude lawyers, accountants, consultants, and other professionals from early stages of discussions because their conception of the professional's role is too narrow. Detailed reporting from professionals is often demanded so that the clients can monitor their activity. What a change this represents! There was a time when clients trusted professionals automatically, based solely upon their honorable calling. Sound character and reputation were assumed, and business was conducted with confidence, bound by a handshake. Great firms and institutions were born and built on this natural expectation of trust. Although that world may be gone, the need for trust has not disappeared. What has taken its place is the necessity to earn trust and maintain it throughout a professional's career. Each of us has run numerous seminars and workshops with a wide variety of professionals on various aspects of dealing with clients. Among the most common questions we receive at these meetings are, 1. How can I get access to my clients more often? 2. How can I persuade my client to introduce me to others in their organization? 3. How can I cross-sell? 4. How can I avoid being typecast, labeled as a specialist only in my main discipline? 5. What do I do about not being an expert in related fields? 6. How do I get clients less focused on price? 7. How do I get clients to play fairly with me? The answers to these questions, and many similar ones, have the same basis. You've got to earn your client's trust. Without that, none of these ambitions can be realized. All these questions require the client to either do something for you or to decide to give you what you want. We believe that a client is most likely to give you what you want if he or she trusts you. We believe that earning trust is an activity that can be managed and improved without trivializing or mechanizing the advisory relationship. In this book, we provide a new understanding of the importance and potential of trust relationships with clients and show how trust can be employed to achieve a wide range of rewards. We examine trust as a process which has beginnings and endings, which can be derailed and encouraged, and which takes place across time and experience. We analyze the key components of trust and the process by which trust evolves in a relationship. We also explore the core capabilities that are exhibited by the trusted advisor, map the trust development process, and reveal the mindsets and behaviors that must be developed to successfully navigate the process. We help you determine the level of trust in your current relationship and show you how to be more worthy of trust and how to make that worthiness manifest to your clients. How to use this book. The terms trust and advisor are seemingly simple words, but they have meanings that contain many layers and complexities. Accordingly, this book approaches our topic from a number of perspectives. The book is like an hourglass, broad and diverse in parts 1 and 3, focused and more tightly integrated in part 2. The chapters in part 1 are full of anecdotes, practical suggestions, illustrations, and stories. They are designed to stimulate your thinking about a variety of interrelated issues, concepts, and skills that trusted advisors must consider. The chapters in Part 2 represent our attempt to bring structure to the topic and are more formal in approach, if not in language. Part 3 is about specific applications. It contains chapters that build on Parts 1 and 2 and apply the concepts and techniques introduced previously. You will quickly discover that we like to use lists. Not only do they convey information concisely, but they also, we hope, invite you to react and modify the lists based on your own thinking and ongoing experience. For your convenience, we have duplicated all of the lists in the book in the appendix. You might find it helpful to use the appendix in any of three ways. 1. Begin this book by skipping to the appendix, which will give you a flavor of what the book contains and where it is going. 2. Use the collected lists therein to quickly identify a topic of particular interest to you and go directly to the relevant portion of the book. 3. Use it after you have finished the book as a quick, ready reference, now and in the future, modifying the lists based on your own ongoing experience. Part 1. Perspectives on Trust. We begin with a brief sneak preview of the book's themes, defining what we mean by the term trusted advisor, and exploring the benefits that accrue to trusted advisors. We then focus on three basic skills that a trusted advisor needs. 1. Earning trust. 2. Giving advice effectively. And 3. Building relationships. Next, we discuss the mindsets or attitudes that are essential to becoming a trusted advisor. In closing, we explore the question of whether building trust is a matter of technique or sincerity, or both. 1. A sneak preview. Let's start with a question. What benefits would you obtain if your clients trusted you more? Here's our list. The more clients trust you, the more they will 1. Reach for your advice. 2. Be inclined to accept and act on your recommendations. 3. Bring you in on more advanced, complex, strategic issues. 4. Treat you as you wish to be treated. 5. Respect you. 6. Share more information that helps you to help them and improves the quality of the service you provide. 7. Pay your bills without question. 8. Refer you to their friends and business acquaintances. 9. Lower the level of stress in your interactions. 10. Give you the benefit of the doubt. 11. Forgive you when you make a mistake. 12. Protect you when you need it, even from their own organization. 13. warn you of dangers that you might avoid. 14. Be comfortable and allow you to be comfortable. 15. Involve you early on when their issues begin to form, rather than later in the process, or maybe even call you first. 16. Trust your instincts and judgments, including those about other people, such as your colleagues and theirs. We would all like to have such professional relationships. This book is about what you must do to obtain these benefits. What changes would you make to this list? What would you add? Delete? Next, let's consider three additional questions. Do you have a trusted advisor? Someone you turn to regularly to advise you on all your most important business, career, and perhaps even personal decisions? If you do, what are the characteristics of that person? If you do not, what characteristics would you look for in selecting your trusted advisor? Here is a listing of traits that our trusted advisors have in common. They 1. Seem to understand us effortlessly and like us. 2. Are consistent, we can depend on them. 3. Always help us see things from fresh perspectives. 4. Don't try to force things on us, it's our decision. 5. Help us think things through. 6. Don't substitute their judgment for ours. 7. Don't panic or get over-emotional. They stay calm. 8. Help us think and separate our logic from our emotion. 9. Criticize and correct us gently. 10. Don't pull their punches. We can rely on them to tell us the truth. 11. Are in it for the long haul. The relationship is more important than the current issue. 12. Give us reasoning to help us think, not just their conclusions. 13. Give us options. Increase our understanding of those options. Give us their recommendation and let us choose. 14. Challenge our assumptions. Help us uncover the false assumptions we've been working under. 15. Make us feel comfortable and casual personally, while still taking the issues seriously. 16. Act like real people, not someone in a role. 17. Are reliably on our side and always seem to have our best interests at heart. 18. Remember what we tell them without notes. 19. Are always honorable. They don't gossip about others to us, and we trust their values. 20. Help us put our issues in context, often through use of metaphors, stories, and anecdotes. Few problems are completely unique. 21. Have a sense of humor to diffuse our tension in tough situations. 22. Are smart, sometimes in ways we're not. What would you add to or delete from this list? Using the traditional golden rule, we should treat others as we wish to be treated, we can probably make a fair assumption, or at least a good first approximation, that this list, or your list, is not much different from a list your clients would make. So, if you want your clients to treat you as their trusted advisor, then you must meet as many of the tests on this list as possible. Ask yourself, which of these traits do my clients think I possess? Not what you think you possess, but what they think you do. If you suspect that you might not demonstrate all these traits, then how do you get better at each of them? That's what this book will try to answer. Note that this book is not just about the wonderful benefits that wait at the end of the rainbow for the full-fledged trusted advisor who does or is everything listed here. The early benefits of beginning to earn trust are substantial and can be obtained quickly. The ability to earn trust is a learnable skill, and we shall try to show the yellow brick road that leads to success. 2. What is a trusted advisor? None of us begins our career as a trusted advisor, but that is the status to which most of us aspire. We usually begin as vendors, performing a specific task or one-off service, employing our technical skills. We may perform with excellence and expertise, but our activities are limited in scope. The fundamental advisory role at this level is to function as a powerful database by providing expert answers to the client's question. As this expertise-based role increasingly gets moved online and somewhat automated, the criticality of the next levels rises. At the next level, the client may sense that we possess capabilities not directly related to our original area of expertise. Additionally, we begin to focus on our ability to define and solve more general problems and not solely to give answers based on our technical mastery. As David puts it, the problem is rarely what the client said it was in the first meeting. For example, Charlie was once consulted by a convenience store chain with over 100% turnover at the store manager level. The client wanted Charlie to develop better hiring criteria to meet the desired profile of longer-term employees. As it turned out, the chain, which was managed largely by ex-military types, administered lie detector tests to all store managers every month to ensure against shrinkage, aka theft. The perverse result was that after a few months, managers began to think someone must be getting away with something, and that maybe they'd try to do so too. They got caught trying, thus reinforcing the perceived need for more lie detector tests, etc., in a self-fulfilling cycle. Needless to say, the problem was not what the client had said it was at the outset, hiring criteria, but rather the management practices of the client organization. The joint definition of problems opens the door to a shared realization of the value at stake. Our clients see us increasingly this way as well, and begin to call upon us for problem definition as the precursor to problem solution, as well as for issues with more breadth. At the third level, we might be consulted on broad strategy issues related to our specific expertise, but not limited only to that expertise. We are no longer seen through the client's eyes as having just technical expertise or problem definition and problem-solving ability, but we are seen as a valued resource in terms of our ability to put issues in context and to provide perspective. We begin to offer advice proactively and to identify issues in their organizational context. The highest level, the pinnacle, is that of trusted advisor, in which virtually all issues, personal and professional, are open to discussion and exploration. The trusted advisor is the person the client turns to when an issue first arises, often in times of great urgency. a crisis, a change, a triumph, or defeat. Issues at this level are no longer seen merely as business or organizational problems, but also involve a personal dimension. Becoming a trusted advisor at the pinnacle level requires an integration of content expertise with organizational and interpersonal skills. Trust doesn't just happen with the passage of time. Typically, it requires a form of personal courage, the will and the skills to raise difficult issues, to communicate empathy and understanding, and the ability to genuinely entertain different and difficult ideas. These levels are a function of both breadth of business issues and depth of personal relationship. By breadth of business issues, we mean the range of business issues in which the advisor gets involved. By depth of personal relationship, we mean the extent to which the client permits us to address their personal relationship to the issues at hand and the business at large. We do not suggest that a professional operating at level 1 is doing something wrong. Far from it. Most of our daily professional lives are spent operating at levels 1 and 2. Relatively little of our time is spent actually working at levels 3 and 4. The issue is not hours in a day, but rather the ability to shift instantly and with ease to any level when necessary. Another way of looking at the types of a client-advisor relationship uses the same axes: breadth of business issues and depth of personal relationship. Marketing people are fond of pointing out three kinds of professional client relationships, which correspond to three approaches to winning business. These are product-service-based, also known as features and benefits; needs-based, often characterized as solutions; and relationship-based approaches, which tend to emphasize not only affinity with the client, but organizational ease of implementation. We think the distinctions are useful, but the conclusions are not quite right. There are times when it is perfectly appropriate and right for a relationship to be service-based or needs-based, and there are times when a particular type of relationship is not the appropriate one. Most important, we feel a fourth type of relationship is missing from the typology, the trust-based relationship. The difference between this and the other levels is the human dimension, the recognition of the interpersonal, individual aspects of the relationship. Pinnacle relationships. Extreme examples are often useful for highlighting key aspects of an issue. One advisor who reached the pinnacle of trust with his client was David Falk, agent to basketball superstar Michael Jordan. Falk helped to create and to build Michael Jordan into one of the world's most successful brands, starting with a major Nike endorsement deal worth $2.5 million plus royalties, back then a pretty big number. Eventually, Jordan endorsed dozens of products, from phone service to golf club covers, and became worth many millions of dollars. Falk, too, profited handsomely from this relationship. With Jordan as a client, he was able to develop an agency that eventually sold for $100 million. Characteristics of relationship levels. Service-based. Focuses on answers, expertise, input. Energy spent on explaining. Client receives information. Indicators of success: timely, high quality. Needs-based. Focuses on business problem. Energy is spent on problem defining, solving. Client receives solutions. Indicators of success? Problems resolved. Relationship-based. Focus is on client organization. Energy spent on providing insights. Client receives ideas. Indicators of success? Repeat business. Trust-based. Focus is on client as individual. Energy spent on understanding the client as person. Client receives safe haven for tough issues. Indicators of success? Win-win. Henry Louis Gates, Jr., writing in The New Yorker, recounted how Falk was exquisitely attuned to Jordan's attitudes about money and Falk's fees. In two instances, Falk reduced or waived specific fees without being asked by Jordan because he knew that's what Jordan wanted, even though Michael would never make such a request. Falk believed that this was one of the reasons the two worked together for so long. Falk represented Jordan for the entirety of his professional career. The trusted advisor acts variously as a mirror, a sounding board, a confessor, a mentor, and even at times, the jester or fool. That's quite a range, yet it becomes evident when powerful leaders describe it. In 1998, the two richest people in the world, Bill Gates and Warren Buffett at the time, held a candid and wide-ranging public dialogue in Seattle, in front of a select crowd of 300 covered by Fortune and NPR. The following excerpt is telling. Gates. It's important to have someone who you totally trust, who is totally committed, who shares your vision, and yet who has a little bit different set of skills, and who also acts as something of a check on you. Some of the ideas you run by him, you know he's going to say, hey, wait a minute, have you thought about this and that? The benefit of sparking off somebody who's got that kind of brilliance is that it not only makes business more fun, but it really leads to a lot of success. Buffett. I've had a partner like that, Charlie Munger, for a lot of years, and it does for me exactly what Bill is talking about. You have to calibrate with Charlie, though, because Charlie says everything I do is dumb. If he says it's really dumb, I know it is, but if he says it's just dumb, I take that as an affirmative vote. Implicit in both Gates and Buffett's description of their trusted advisors is something easy to overlook. The ability of their advisor to deeply pay attention to their client. This ability to focus on the other person is evident in virtually all the trusted advisors we have encountered. We are not aware of any one approach that they have taken to get there. Some seem to have been born that way, with a blend of curiosity, equanimity, and quiet self-assurance that permits them to easily focus their attention on others. The rest of us have to learn it, and it's not the easiest thing to learn. It requires an emotional maturity and an ego strong enough to share one's locus of attention with another. In the deepest and most complete trusted advisor relationships, there are few boundaries within the relationship, like separation between professional and personal issues. Both members of the relationship fully know about each other and understand the role the other plays in his or her life. Regina M. Pisa, Chairman Emeritus of Goodwin, a Global 50 law firm, describes the most unusual and special trusted advisor relationship. I had a CEO client call me. He was leaving an appointment at Massachusetts General Hospital and wanted to come over right away. He walked in with his wife and said that they had just been told that he was terminally ill, with not much time left. He said, I'm fearful for my wife. She doesn't have someone like you in her life who she can call on for anything, and I want to do for her what you did for me. We're putting ourselves in your hands to help us through all of this." Getting the estate planning in order was the easy part. What they were asking for was for me to help them deal with the whole thing, before and after death. There's no greater definition of a trusted advisor, no greater reward than when you develop bonds with clients that run so deep. This story stands as an object lesson for what can be achieved when we are willing to expand into trusted advisor territory. Not all of us might choose to aim for relationships as deep as this one, but the story reveals that there are no limits to the depth to which a trusting relationship can go, other than those imposed by the advisor and the client. Clients like Ms. Pisa's are the best clients, because they understand the value of what you provide. In the push-pull of work, there are always deal pressures, missed deadlines, and so forth. Clients are not always understanding. They might be unreasonable in their expectations. But when you have relationships like this, clients treat you well. Characteristics of successful, trusted advisors. Professionals who apply trust most successfully are those who are at ease with concepts like do well by doing good. What goes around comes around. You get back what you put in. Use it or lose it. These maxims are ways of suggesting that success comes to those who have chosen not to make success their primary goal. The way to be as rich as Bill Gates is to care more about writing code than about being rich. And the way to be a great advisor is to care about your client. A common trait of all these trusted advisor relationships is that the advisor places a higher value on maintaining and preserving the relationship itself than on the outcomes of the current transaction, financial and otherwise. Often, the advisor will make a substantial investment in the client without a guarantee of return before the relationship does, in fact, generate any income, let alone any profit. Consider, for example, Marjorie Ziffrin, for 40 years a prominent investment advisor to high net worth individuals and families in Hawaii. Early in my career, I learned that building relationships with other advisors is as important as building client relationships. Understanding the client's needs and comfort levels is step one. Helping them to build a team of professional advisors that work together as a team forges deep relationships, not only with clients, but also with advisors. Understanding the needs of advisors and the style of collaboration is equally as important. My approach is to collaborate and coordinate. To that end, I attend as many meetings as possible with clients and advisors. I serve as the team quarterback, keeping all parties informed. I collaborate with clients and advisors to understand each of their needs. I get to really know and understand my clients and their families. I also learn what the other advisors need to provide, their input and expertise. It is not uncommon for clients to ask me for referrals to other advisors in a variety of areas. I don't try to replace existing relationships. My role is to leverage and support key relationships which clients have developed over years. For example, if the client has an investment broker, even though I am securities licensed, I will simply serve as an advisor coordinator. I am there to augment, to find ways to add value, to be the quarterback who might pass things to others, not to carry the ball alone, to continue the football analogy. It's in the coordination, putting things together. It's like a jigsaw puzzle. and these are really complex relationships. I take it as much more of a sacred trust than as a professional referral. Based on the examples and many trusted advisors we have encountered in our careers, we believe the following attributes describe trusted advisors. Trusted advisors, 1. Have a predilection to focus on the client rather than themselves. They have enough self-confidence to listen without prejudging. Enough curiosity to inquire without supposing an answer. A willingness to see the client as co-equal in a joint journey. Enough inner confidence to subordinate their own ego. 2. Focus on the client as an individual, not as a person fulfilling a role. 3. Believe that a continued focus on problem definition and resolution is more important than technical or content mastery. 4. Show a strong, competitive drive aimed not at competitors, but at constantly finding new ways to be of greater service to the client. 5. Consistently focus on doing the next right thing, rather than on aiming for specific outcomes. 6. Are motivated more by an internalized drive to do the right thing than by their organization's rewards or dynamics. 7. View methodologies, models, techniques, and business processes as a means to an end. They are useful if they work and are to be discarded if they don't. The test is effectiveness for this client. 8. Believe that success in client relationships is tied to the accumulation of quality experiences. As a result, they seek out client contact experiences and take personal risks with clients rather than avoid them. 9. Believe that both selling and serving are aspects of professionalism. Both are about proving to clients that you are dedicated to helping them with their issues. 10. Believe that there is a distinction between a business life and a private life, but that both lives are very personal, that is, human. They recognize that refined skills in dealing with other people are critical in business and in personal life. The two worlds are often more alike than they are different, and for some, they overlap to an extraordinary extent. The benefits of being a trusted advisor. To begin with the obvious commercial point, a trusted advisor benefits from having trusting relationships because they lead to repeat business from the same client. These relationships also lead to new business through referrals from existing clients. These relationships are also less plagued by pro forma procedures, such as proposals, presentations, studies, activity reports, and the like. In such a relationship, the parties find a way to reconfigure such processes for greater efficiency and effectiveness. In short, these relationships can be highly profitable and more enjoyable for the trusted advisor. Another benefit is that in a trusting relationship, the advisor is able to employ the most prized individual skills and powers, listening, reasoning, problem solving, and imagining, and apply them to subjects that truly matter. Time can be spent with a decision maker with substantial power to affect an organization, create new initiatives, harness resources, and get things done. Trust frees us from the need to spend time on inconsequential projects or tedious procedural issues. The world of media production provides an example of the efficiency benefits of trust relationships. Consider the stories of two, disguised, producers of documentaries. Producer Thomas has, over the years, developed relationships of trust with a small number of acquisition executives, those in charge of developing and commissioning programs, and created a number of successful shows with and for them. Now, to sell a new program, he simply creates a brief document, 2 to 3 pages, describing the basic idea. There is no subject that an experienced executive has not received a proposal about, he says. For the programmer, it's not about receiving a voluminous and costly proposal. It's about working with a producer they trust. If they like the idea and need more information, they'll ask for it. If not, they'll simply give me the green light. Producer Atkins, on the other hand, has a far less established reputation, and following a less than successful relationship with one programmer, no strong trust relationship. As a result, he is forced to devote a great deal of time to producing weighty proposals that contain complete program treatments, biographies of the key team members, detailed budgets, and complex schedules, all elaborately produced. He exhausts himself and his staff in creating these proposals, only a fraction of which are, or can be, successful. As a result, he has produced fewer documentaries than producer Thomas and earns less money. Finally, one of the most significant rewards of a trusted advisor relationship, for both client and advisor, is that in such a relationship, the individuals are allowed to be fully who they are. The members of the relationship do not expend energy protecting themselves, and both can be open with information about their lives, their strengths, and their weaknesses. They share information and ideas, feel comfortable with themselves, and have great access to their emotions and inspirations. Above all, this means we as advisors have the greatest chance to tune our advice and our service offerings to the real and whole needs of our clients. This is true in all trusted advisor relationships, though it's more evident in some. Financial planning industry guru Michael Kitz's Nerd's Eye View blog, XY Planning Network, and more, see kitzes.com, says, "A bad recommendation can destroy someone's 40 years of savings and fiscal responsibility. Good advice can change the trajectory of someone's life. Money can lead to divorce, suicide, or profound happiness." This is very core human stuff. It's hard not to tie up your earnings and your financial net worth with what you are worth as a human being.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.